Hey, good evening, everyone. This is Tazlik here, and hope you are having a nice day. So today we'll be discussing about doing SRE the right way. This is a series in which Piyush and some other folks will be talking about their experiences in keeping the lights on over the last few years and their experiences which they have gained over doing prod support and whatnot in order to enable the companies to run the way they are and without having any outages or minimum outages, so as to say. So, without much ado, I'll just give a short introduction about RootConf. So, RootConf, if you folks would have been attend, I'm sure some of you would have been attending RootConf for the last couple of years, in which a lot of practitioners come in and gather to discuss their ideas and their implementations about how they have been achieving reliability as well as solving real world problems inside their organizations, so as to speak. With that in place, I'll just give a short introduction about myself. I'm your co-host. I'm Tazlik. I work at Gojek at the like at this moment, which is where I would be in the platform team. Before this, I was at Razorpay as the fourth engineer in the infrastructure team. All right then, I think Piyush, I'll hand over the stage to you.
Hi, this is first of the three-part series that I have about doing SRE the right way.
Well, the jinx just happened. Did we just lose Piyush?
Hey folks, sorry for the inconvenience. I think we are facing a connectivity issue from the host. We will be right back. But in the meantime, can we have a quick show of hands on the chat screen about by just saying a hi or act by giving introduction of what the demographics are of the audience? If you work in the platform engineering team or in your DevOps team or in your infrastructure team or site reliability engineering team, we would just like to see a show of hands of who like what you folks are up to, or if you can just say hi, that would be awesome. Hey Shiva, how are you doing today? Can you hear us, Shiva?
Hello, back.
Yeah,
Hey.
I can hear you.
Hi, how are you
Yeah.
doing today?
Thank you. Good. How are you?
Awesome, awesome. So,
Yeah.
how did you come to know about RootConf?
Yeah, so I was just browsing in LinkedIn and Facebook, so I came to know that. Then I registered. I looked at very interesting topics over there, so I used to attend a couple of conferences like this. So I look at this one as well. It was very interesting. So just registered myself to know where to understand more about SRE side and all the stuffs. And currently I'm working as a DevOps lead over there. So working
Oh,
and
awesome.
taking care for the entire project delivery on
That's
DevOps
awesome. Yeah,
area
that's awesome.
along with platform engineer.
That's really interesting. So,
Yeah.
without much ado, I think Piyush is back. Shiva, we
Yeah,
would
yeah.
love to hear more about what you folks do with
Sure,
your
sure.
company, and we can share a lot of ideas, and I hope we all will be able to learn a few things from you.
Sure, sure.
Without much ado, giving the stage to Piyush. I'll be muting you,
Yeah,
Shiva.
yeah. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, this is the thing, the vendor tell you that systems are reliable, network is never. Every network will fail, always. Anyway, so frequent question that I keep getting asked, you know, what is SRE. How is it different from DevOps? How much does reliability cost? How long before I am reliable? Isn't it too early to automate? What does NSRE code? Is reliability achieved before or after a release?
Are you sharing the screen?
Is it not with you? Then let me just share it. It would just be because I got disconnected. Is it there?
Yep.
All right. Sorry for the glitch. Yeah, you can ask your question in comments as well, but these are the general questions that I keep getting asked. Before I go about answering them, I would like to take a stab at answering what is a failure cycle of a physical product. A physical product that you use, it has a burn-in rate over a period of time where you're trying to almost put it in an auto mode. Every car that you buy, a new car that you buy, it's not really brand new. You know, it has gone through a warning cycle of a certain 1,000 kilometers, albeit on rollers, before it becomes usable. It becomes usable, it stays usable, and then it starts wearing out. And then the failure rate increases. You know, this is why an old refrigerator, an old car, or an old air conditioner, or old television will always start doing issues. There's a certain, this is called a bucket graph, and this is how typically every physical product goes. Software products, on the other hand, have a very typical failure rate cycle. First, when you start, obviously, there are a lot of bugs. You keep testing, you keep debugging, and you try to bring the rate down till it becomes usable. If you make an observation here, that graph doesn't touch zero of failure rate because it's almost impossible to eliminate every bug from a software, you know, every known bug. Because you don't know what are the known bugs. So you bring it to a point where it is acceptable, usable to known cases, and then you release an upgrade. The moment you release an upgrade, there are failures because the code is going to meet newer runtime conditions. This is typically, this may look as a surprise, but how often have you used an iPhone and they launch a new update and you realize that, hey, this something is broken, something's not working. They reduce the bugs, then there's a newer upgrade, which has more bugs. They reduce the bugs. This cycle goes on and on. Over a period of time, till the software becomes obsolete, and then there are more bugs. One fair conclusion here that we can make is that a software which is obsolete is almost one of the most stable ones, because there's literally nothing which is being added to it any further than what used to be there. Also, the first bar, the first lambda that was there is slightly lower than the last one. What it means is that over a period of time, a software actually accumulates more bugs than what it began with. Same conclusion here to draw would be, there's a constant tussle between the release velocity and stability of a system. Well, while many may disagree with this, but take a moment to understand this. As you release more frequently, obviously you have less time to run that code through the production scenarios. Production scenarios of multi-AZ, production scenarios of bad internet, production scenarios of stress, of the real world stress, when rubber meets the road. And hence, in a way, you are actually saying that I will release more, and in hindsight, you're compromising a bit of stability. This is a seesaw. When you see a release going too often and actually breaking things, you start favoring stability. This is a constant battle that needs to be handled. Historically, what are the approaches that have been to handle reliability in software? Well, first is, this is my favorite point, you know, like ignorance. Don't care about it. I wish I could do that more. Second is throw more engineers at a problem. You know, like we bring all hands on deck. There are more and more number of people who are actually trying to fix things, which is why, like, you know, standard on call, I've been a part of it, starts with one person. Very soon, within a matter of 10 minutes, there are 20 people on the call. If the issue still persists, there are going to be 30 people on the call. And suddenly everybody on the floor is actually on call. But these are more ad hoc mechanisms. What are the more computer science principles? Recovery blocks. You know, we've been taught that this is what we shamelessly actually borrow from hardware failures if it doesn't work reboot. And that's the same principle that we install in things like, you know, when we advocate things like Hystrix, etc. And we say that if it doesn't work once, try with exponential backoffs, recovery block of retry, etc. While it is good for transient issues, any DNA defects or any software, any faults which exist in a software are not going to be fixed by it. An attempt to solve that was done in 1977. And this thing is called N-version programming. So the idea of N-version programming was you have a simple problem statement, you give it to two set of teams of engineering, and they will produce two different implementations quite obviously. They will have unique bugs. You try and merge those code bases in a way where you take the best of both and you have almost eliminated the bugs. While this worked, it actually was proven by the same guy who wrote the theory called Michael Liu that this thing actually doesn't work. You give the same set of problem to same to different set of teams, they almost identically produce the same set of bugs. So if the input doesn't change, almost all engineers make the same mistake, which is kind of funny because this was done back in 1985. And that is when a new research paper was written, which was about self-checking software. And in 1985, Michael Liu talks about that a software needs to be fed with more and more data and more control instrumentation needs to be fed in where it can take decisions. You know, like simple mechanisms like a runtime system can be introduced with SIGHUB. You can actually send interrupts and then it can start behaving differently. The key element here is to achieve this, you require a decent, rather an insane amount of observability, comprehensive set of metrics at every single step of the way of the software and control, obviously. Policies that actually adhere to production. Like we have static checks, you know, for our code bases, we don't have any such thing called dynamic runtime checks. While I'm writing my software, I really do not know how, what the real world simulation is going to be, which can actually tell me while writing my code that this is going to break. Interestingly, this is for the reliability of a software. But if I was to ask the same question to my product people, you know, like what features work, what features don't work out there, this aspect of software development has actually advanced pretty well. And a leaf that we want to borrow from there is that software operation should be treated like a product. What we mean by that is, if you look at a product aspect, you know, it has a product manager. There's customer feedback, they're constantly talking to the customers. There are product metrics, say a name, you know, like when you try to install those Ghostry kind of plugins, you'll realize that every single web page out there is almost tracking events out of every single click of yours. You know, like a product guy can almost tell you which feature was not utilized, what feature gets used most on a Sunday, which gender uses what feature. And everything, like there's so much tracking happening around there. There are conversion funnels, people know where did a person get dropped out, at what point did a user actually decide to abandon a cart, at what point did they decide to buy one, and they can influence decisions as well. Whereas operations, on the other hand, is still run ad hoc. It's one failure at a time. And this is vastly different because when you develop a product and when you're launching a new feature, you do a sprint plan. There are things which are thought over a period of weeks and over a period of days that you build it. Fast forward it to a runtime system and operations. Things are thought within minutes. Operations are applied within seconds. Now, these things are bound to fail because obviously you do not have time to think. And when you don't have that much time, there are going to be mistakes. You're going to actually introduce newer failures. What it requires is data-driven decisions. Prioritizing your failures. If I was to ask a product guy, should I actually change my sign-up button's location or should I go implement a cart checkout? Z, he or she would have an answer to this. They would know which one has higher priority or more business value to something. We don't have same set of answers towards our losses, our failures. How do we prioritize our failures? There's a disk going down right now. It's 90% full at 4 a.m. Should I even wake up or should I not wake up? Because I don't have, I mean, every bug cannot be a high priority thing. How do I put a loss to it? Why should something be up 24/7? What is the business that we're going to lose with it? These decisions, the lack of it, makes operations really chaotic and ad hoc. And which is why, you know, like there are memes and jokes out there that people actually, developers hate doing the operations job because Because it's stressful. It is. I want to take a break. I want to show you a tweet. This was something that I asked on Twitter. Those who scale GCP and AWS, how often do you hit a resource limit before you can scale out? Am I still on the call? Can somebody give me an affirmation? Because my internet is weak.
Hey. I can hear you.
Yep.
Oh, perfect. All right. Good. Good roll call. At least everybody is awake as well. Yeah. So how do you hit a, how often do you know before you hit a resource limit before you scale out? Interestingly, you know, like people said, they don't hit out. They don't hit any such issue. 36%, 23.7%. Let's say round it off. 25% say that we have a person for that. 15% say we have a tool for that. 25% say that very often. When you view it from an SRE lens, what are the things that we see? We see that 35% of these people have not scaled enough yet. Because if they were to scale out on a day and they're going to hit this limit, think about it, you know, I got so much traffic coming in. I need to add more servers. I need to launch one more server, but I cannot because I've hit a resource limit. I need to send a request ticket to AWS to actually allow me to spawn up one more C5.xlr system. These people have just not hit that yet. This is what NSRE sees. Last and the first option, 50% have to wait before they scale out. They are not really automated because if they were automated, they would not be hitting these issues or they would not have a person. You know, like when they say, I have a person for this, clearly that person is not checking this by the second or by the minute. You know, like, oh, is my resource limit still active? Is my resource limit still active? What that means is that the next time that they hit this issue, they're actually waiting that a person will solve. So this is not really actually going automated. Now, another thing that I see, 25% people are actually paying a person to just do this. 35% people are going to hit a problem at some point of time. This is what I see. Point here that you need to extract data out of every such situation, and we are trying to look into the future. You know, as SREs, you always try to look into the future. This is the whole essence of site reliability engineering. I want to take back to one of the exercises that we did at one of my previous gigs. You know, we had, I would say, a lower 90% around item uptime. And one of our first tasks was that because we were losing business because of it, we had to bring it up. So me and this friend of mine, we were working together. So one day we just decided that, look, we're going to gather data at every single issue that has been brought up, every single error and exception that has been raised in the system. It's kind of a daunting task, but we decided we're going to do it anyway because we needed to measure that what needs to be improved to actually bring that number from 90 to 99, at least to begin with, or 95 was the first target. We started collecting data at every single node of the process. One, actual errors that were being tracked in logs, issues that were actually being alerted into Slack. Then how many of those became a pager duty alert? How many of those resulted in a Zendesk ticket or could be correlated to a Zendesk ticket, and how many issues were actually closed? Our first ambition here was identifying the leakage in this funnel. You draw a corollary here. We are actually trying to do the same conversion funnel that a product guy does. What we're trying to identify is that how many errors leave the exception trace, become either a Slack alert, or become a pager duty alert, and then tie themselves to a customer's Zendesk ticket and then get resolved. If there is a drop anywhere which did not go all the way through, we know that issue is getting leaked and that's going to happen again. Next was, then we put a business value. We asked the business and the product guys, right, which one of these issues actually resulted in how much loss. Next, we prioritize it. What the 80-20 rule, the standard one. By doing 20% of the effort, what are the first most 80% of the things that we can actually address? Because that will give us the maximum gain, and then we'll keep reiterating the cycle. Then we hand over a primitive plan to product and ops team. We are an operations team. We called ourselves an operations team, but this is what we used to go over every single fortnight. Every single fortnight, this was a churn that we had to go through. We started producing some data. The screen might be slightly too bright and white, but I can just go over this. We started capturing the mean time to respond for a given issue and the mean time to close an issue as well. There were the amount of cloud spend that we're doing per project as well, so that we could keep up on, we could keep out a value, because we could know that by expanding the servers on this, we're going to spend this much. And because we already have the data of the losses, we could take a very good financial stab at this is what it costs to actually solve these bugs. So fair to say that the question of raising 90 bar to 95, we could actually put a numerical value to it in terms of dollars. We also are carrying deployment velocity, which is how many times does a release fail before it becomes a green? All of this data, we're capturing it. Just put it into a graph just for make it easy to consume. Interesting thing that we observe in this MTTR to MTT, the mean time to close an issue. It took 30,000 seconds for an engineer to actually pick up an issue, which is almost next to 9 to 10 hours here. You know, like actually it's 8 hours. And then once a ticket was picked up, the first mean time to respond, the time to close that was only 1800 seconds away. So what you're seeing here is that this is a very interesting stat, because while running a team, I wanted to know where should I put more resources in. And this told me that once an issue was picked up, it only took half an hour to solve the issue. What that meant was there was not a lack of motivation to solve a problem, because if there was, this time would have been great. There wasn't lack of tooling. There was enough tooling that we had built by then. This was sheerly the amount of workload that was there. You know, I'm giving an example of what else do we need to capture. We need to capture the team's burn as well. And this was a good symptom of it, that it takes, the backlog is so that it almost takes around 8 hours to pick a task, but only half an hour to close the issue. So we knew where do we have to make the next set of investment.
Hey, Piyush, sorry to interrupt you. Yes. So we have a quick question if you want to take it right now. So someone.
Oh, yes, I would love to.
So, yeah. Someone is asking, how did we produce these stats?
Yes. If you could hold on, I can answer this later, or and try giving a preemptive answer right now, because I do cover that how do we produce the stats. So, but to give you a quick one, so the first thing that we do is we actually plumb together every single source of metrics or information that we have in a movable system. One. Well, for this dashboard or the next one? This one's fairly straightforward. When we start looking at our Elasticsearch, we start finding how many errors are there. We take that number. Second, we actually do a simple click on how many Slack errors were raised. PagerDuty has an API. We start pulling that number out of there. Zendesk has an API as well. So these numbers are found. Build very simple a cohort analysis to see which one these were. It gives us the funnel of what is being lost. These numbers, this is simple, straightforward. On a Google API, you will find this way. So on a GC pool in the cloud space, CSV, which produced every end of a day or every second day, we take that and retrospectively add it at how much resources are consumed. We use Connect as a central job mechanism. Deployment failures were actually captured. Mean time to respond was captured again from Zendesk and GitHub and wherever the issues would come. So I think that should answer it quickly on how these dashboards were produced.
Awesome. I think that answers that, Piyush. Thank you for taking the question in the middle of the session. If you could just bring the mic closer, we have a few attendees noting about the voice.
Is this better?
I think this is better.
Yeah, okay, cool, perfect.
Thank you.
Now, if I say that, hey, all of this is site reliability engineering, the question is, where do we start about this? The first question that we answered and asked ourselves was, what exactly is reliability? You know, we say that this is less reliable, more reliable, but that's just a qualitative metric, qualitative. We need to add a number to it. We need to measure this. So what exactly are we measuring? Because if I tell you that, hey, you're going to do better in your exams next time around, how do I measure that you're doing better? If I say, hey, become a good person tomorrow, how do you measure you're a good person? If there's anything which is an adjective, you need to measure it. When we ask ourselves that question that, hey, how do we improve this, is when like what number should actually change if I really have to go to my management to say that, hey, this money was worth, it was worthwhile that you spent on us. And like, if you have to justify our job, what is it that we're improving? Here's an example. So we usually traditionally say that, hey, reliability is mostly about uptime. You know, we say this word uptime. Uptime means that, hey, while your service is up, I'm going to get a response from it. simple, straightforward. In my next talk, I'll actually cover on why this simple term saying that uptime is actually quite tricky as well. It's one of the simplest metric, but one of the toughest ones to do. But for this, for the sake of this talk, let's say that there's an uptime. Now, there's a service, there's an issue, a live issue. I won't take the name of which project this is from. It returns a 200, even if the response body has an error in it. And this issue has been open for a fairly long time. You know, this keeps getting repeated. This one was opened on April 23rd, but this has been actually coming up in different ways since, I think, 2015 or 2014. Now, an uptime doesn't mean that the service is reliable, because clearly the service is returning errors, but the health check is returning a success. Now, these errors are pretty tricky to handle, because your standard monitoring tool will not work, because now you need to actually parse the body as well. On the right, what I have is, you may not be able to see it very clearly, but it's a mobile phone. I'm trying to place an order on Swiggy. They're great service. I'm not calling them out here. I'm just giving an example. Everybody faces these errors. So in here, the web app is working. I'm able to place an order, but I'm not able to go through the payment process of a checkout. Well, quite clearly, the standard principle of retry has been applied, which is why you see nested boxes, a retry block, retry block, retry block, but clearly the payment is not going through. So does it mean that this, despite being up, is it reliable? It's clearly not. So it's not just about uptime. There is more to it. Reliability has to have more factors. Now, if I was to ask a more broader question, and I say that, should it be up? Or am I trying to say that service should be up and not serve errors? Or am I trying to say that it should be up, not serve errors, and also serve correct data? Even if it serves correct data, within what time? Should it serve within no time, 0 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, what? Should it serve unlimited transactions per second? What is it? Should I switch off my video?
Yes, hey Piyush, I think let's try with switching off your video so the bandwidth issue doesn't.
Okay, is this any better?
I think so, yes. Let's see. Let's
okay,
see.
Cool. Do we have a nod from people to say that we can actually hear this? Cool. Yeah. I assume, okay. Should I move forward?
I think it's better, yes. Yeah.
Okay, Lower. Great. Yeah. Am I going to say that, hey, this has to be served within X time? Or are we saying that, hey, this has to serve unlimited transactions per second? Or are we saying that, hey, all of these requests have to be served concurrently? What exactly am I trying to achieve when I say that, hey, this is reliability? When faced with so many questions is when we started to wonder, what is the real difference between a robust system and a reliable system? You know, because until then, we did not have this clarity. And that's when we started realizing that robust systems are only the ones where you inject errorless input and it still holds itself. But the reliable system is the one which has to actually go through all of these runtime behaviors which the system has not even been coded for. Which one and how do we get is the answer yes to everything? Before we make that decision, we have to understand that reliability is not a buffet lunch. It's a line item that you're going to pay for every single thing that you order. Every single thing that you order has a price to it, and also there are taxes on top of it. These taxes come in terms of you having to provide for more and more infrastructure, more testing infrastructure, more time, more team, more management overhead, HR costs, laptop costs, internet costs, everything that you can think of. You know, like all of this is what you pay when you ask for more and more reliability. Also, one thing which is worthy of being noted here is that there is never a bug-free system. You cannot have 100% reliable software. This is fairly easy to say, but if you go the real mathematical reason for this is to say something works, the proof of it has to be established. And every axiom has a proof. To prove something is 100% complete is impossible, because nobody knows all the error systems, error conditions that can happen in this world. Like, nor I, nor anybody can actually claim that, hey, I know all the errors that can happen and this system works well for it. It's almost impossible to say that. And hence, it's almost impossible to say that, hey, there can be a system which is 100% reliable. How do we get there? Now, what do we do? So to start actually answering this question of what reliability do I need, there is a concept called service level indicators. The first thing is to actually monitor the indicators. An service level indicator, which basically calls out, that gives a sort of metric to, hey, this is the number of requests that I'm serving right now, this is the current latency, et cetera, et cetera. You know, something that can actually give a qualitative metric to how the service is working. The next set is that you ask is, for each one of those service level indicators, we set a service level objective. For example, in this case, we'll say that we're closed due to short staff, so we shouldn't hire taller staff. Okay. Service level objectives are like gears of your car. Coming back to the same point that we're making, you have to pick between a release velocity and a reliability of a system. What happens here is that every single time that we keep deploying, we are actually exposing our system to more and more erroneous conditions, more and more situations where it may fail. And these service level objectives that we set allow us to change the gears of our effort. When I say our, I'm actually speaking on behalf of the operations team here. And I'm not using the word site reliability engineering team as of yet. I'm only calling this entire domain as operations. The release velocity needs to be captured. If we are doing pretty well, with example of a service level objective, we'll go through that. How do we set service level objectives? I just wanted to give you an idea of what can these service level objectives do. How do we go about setting these service level objectives? The first key point here is that it has to be measurable. Now, when I say that this is my objective, it has to be a numeric number or something which can be measured against a SLR. Second, it has to be customer oriented. I can't have anything which pleases me internally or my team internally. This has to save something on the revenue or the business end. These have to be challenging. Setting a service level objective as, hey, we aim to deploy once a month, is not going to achieve anything. They have to be unambiguous, very crystal clear. You know, they cannot be challenged in a court. All stakeholders participate. Now, this is a very interesting one because a service level objective is not set by one team. Multiple people come together, which involves the product team, the development, the software head, the business guys, and also the operations guys come together and say that, hey, our goal is to actually serve 99% of our customers to be happy. How do we break this down? We'll cover this up. And this has a cost to it. Now, but the release team says that, look, we can't do this because there's already a pending release of so much. We can't actually introduce these new features because we haven't tested them. But this is what a QA team would say. Like every car, the slowest moving wheel is as fast as you go. The lowest confidence that the team, one of the teams will have, is the maximum service level objective that you can set. By using all of this information, if we actually go about now setting real service level objectives, what do they look like? Instead of saying that my service should be up all the time, we would come up with a very realistic figure that I should be up through the day. But having looked at my service level indicators, I can deduce that 3 till 3:15 a.m. is where I get the least amount of traffic. It's, you're lucky that you may not find any traffic at that point of time, or unlucky from the business sense. But this is the only downtime which is allowed. So if I have to deploy, I have to deploy within this period. Now, this simple statement has multiple implications here. Because carefully look, this is just a 15-minute window. If I really have to get my deployment all right in 15 minutes, the amount of preparation that goes behind it is going to be massive. I'll have to do a canary. I'll have to take dumps of the production data and then run testing systems against it to make sure that it works. It has massive cost to it. Every single service level objective has a line item of a cost that needs to be paid next to it. Or what we say is, hey, don't serve all the requests. No, that is ambiguous. What we say is only 1% of my requests should have status code which is greater than 400. So that is only 1% of errors are allowed. Or I could do a deep health check and I say only 0.05% of these deep health checks should fail. Now, usually what we say is that, hey, my system has to be fast. And I say that, hey, my P95, one of the most common terms, or P99 has to be 100 milliseconds. This metric and this service level objective has to be actually inverted. A P99 latency of 100 milliseconds means 1% of your request base is actually worse than 100 milliseconds. That's the amount that you have to compromise. And that's the question that you ask yourself. If is it the 1% user base I'm willing to lose? And that's the number that I'll set. If you say that, no, I can't even lose 1% of my user base, then you say, okay, fine, I got to lower down this number as well, and there's a higher cost that I have to pay for it. Same goes for transactions per second and concurrency as well. In the next talk, we'll discuss how TPS is different from concurrency, but if you guys already are aware of that, that you'll get the gist of it. I take one more detailed stab at these service level objectives. Example, a SLO of 99% of a service allows for 1 million requests in a month, will only allow 10,000 failures to happen. You know, this is the kind of, what we're saying is from the business team, we have gotten a requirement that look, I'm okay with 1% of the request failing. So we are saying that 10,000 failures. Now, how do we change these gears? Let's take an example of it. I'm 14 days into my month as an operations team. I realize that the number of errors that we have hit is already 9,000. What this means and it quickly suggests is, this, we need all hands towards stability on the deck right now. There is nothing that we can do about releasing any further because we have depleted our allowance. We have depleted our pocket money. We don't have any more funds coming in. Let's move towards stability. But on the other side, if 14 days into the month, I only had 500 errors. Well, okay, all hell break loose, release as much as you want. We can actually break software if we want because, well, we have permission to actually innovate, so why not innovate? This is what a SLO, a well-defined SLO can do as a culture. It can actually change gears. Now, this may change over the next month. This may change dynamically based on a feedback that I'm getting. So this is what an SLO does, a well-defined SLO. Another aspect of defining the service level objectives is a time window of it. This is very important because am I counting these numbers over a week or a month or a year? You know, a 99% downtime would actually mean that over a year, I can have what, like 4 days, but over a month, it would only mean 52 minutes. What that means is that if I take it over a year, is it okay from Christmas till New Year, my shop is shut? No, I can't have that, right? I mean, legitimately, I'm within my SLO, but it may have an adverse effect on the system. So it's not like you keep collecting this ration and you actually use it at the end of the year. It's not that. You have to pick up a rolling window, which is usually we say that is a month, because a week is too short, because you may change something over a week and it takes a week for the results to show up. So you actually pick a wise number of saying that let's do a rolling window of 1 month. Now, when you do a rolling window of 1 month, there's a challenge because a month is never even. There are sometimes 31 days, there are sometimes 28 days, sometimes 29 days, sometimes 30 days, right? So this number is going to get imbalanced again. So you pick up a very fixed concrete number. So pay attention. What we're trying to say is that these numbers have to be very clinical, because if your businesses and your decisions rely on these numbers, they better be accurate. You know, it can't be, well, I am almost 99-ish uptime. You know, like it can't work that way. Or I am, you know, like it's like that famous dialogue from the movie Anchorman. 60% of the time, this works every time. Favorite dialogue. I wish I could give that every time somebody asks me how often your system is up. You know, choosing aggregation. This is also important. Do we actually pick individual or aggregations? Window lengths. This we already spoke. So these are also what actually define a very good SLO here. We didn't speak of any automation or any engineering so far. We have only spoken of what needs to be done. All of this could have been done on spreadsheets. In fact, that is what we're doing. We're actually building, like I was blessed with a guy who was really good at spreadsheets. And we almost did all of this with spreadsheets. But beyond the point, spreadsheets and manual effort will stop. You know, like engineering's core function is it allows you to do what humans do, only more repeatable, faster, and economical. One, you can pick two of these three of these three, whatever, but there's no fourth utility of engineering. And this is where we introduce engineering in this whole site. We understood what reliability is. We understand why reliability is. Now we understand why engineering is. Because think about crunching all of this data, gathering all of this data by the hour, by the minute, by the second as events come. It's almost impossible to do it manually. What else does it SRE?
Hey, Piyush. Sorry to interrupt. There's just a quick question since we were covering SLO and getting over with it. So there's a question about from Ashutosh. If he asks if it is allowed SLO, does it mean as error budget?
Yes, error budget is a terminology that we actually pick from Google's book, but I usually do not actually use that terminology. What I mean that by allowed failure is an appetite, which is saying that, yeah, it's almost corollary to saying that there's an error budget. But yes, clearly suggests that you have actually done good amount of homework on SRE. So yeah, it is clearly that error budget. But for others who probably haven't read that book, what it means is what we're saying is that the business, because what we said, right, there's a cost to everything. They say that, right, I get it. It takes me 10 engineers or it takes me 2 on-call engineers and this much amount of infrastructure budget. So it takes me $5,000 to reach 99%. And these numbers are very interesting. You know, like they, like what we realized was these numbers do not grow linearly. What we paid to go from 90 to 95 was almost 1/3 of what we paid from 95 to 99, which was 1/10 of we paid from 99 to 99.5. You know, these numbers keep exponentially increasing because the amount of time to react, you know, like 99.99 means 4 minutes of downtime only over a year. This is an insane amount of number, right? So this is what error budget and what these numbers actually suggest. It basically brings in an appetite based on a lot of factors. I hope that answers the question.
Right, I think we can cover that. Just if you are open for another question, we can take it up since it is on SLO, or do you want me to take it later?
I can take it up if it's a quick one, for sure.
Yeah, so Ajit asks if there are like standard SLOs which you follow in particular.
It depends again on the same answer that I say, that this is really a function of how much. Actually, let me cover that later. There's a slide for it very next after this, which will actually answer that question. Let me come to that, right?
Awesome.
Yeah, cool. So what else does an SRE do? When an outage happens, so these are the three motors that a site reliability engineering is supposed to do. You know, like if you want to put slap OKRs on an SRE team, it comes out of these three things. When an outage happens, minimize the downtime. If earlier by any effort, there used to be 1 hour of outage, we now must have less than that. This number has to improve. Second question, where else is this happening? Where else is this happening is a very interesting question. Say I ran into an issue because of which a payment service failed, because my redis went out of disk. My next question to be asked is, where, and let's say if I fix this and I require a restart on payment service, the very next question that hits our head is, what other service was dependent on this? Before I move my attention away from the system right now, I must patch and fix everything that is there in the purview of this, because that is another failure that is waiting to happen. The next thing that we do is, how do we actually prevent these issues from happening? That is a very real one, because this is where really engineering comes into play. You know, and this is very interesting that we actually realize as a number, 38% of our issues were actually repeat recurring same issue on same nodes. And we could have done a better job of it. Only when we started capturing it, we started realizing that, hey, this is actually the same issue and we need to do something out of this. And when faced with that, you actually take better decisions. So this is one of the three principles that SRE always follows. What is the recipe behind it? One, insane amount of observability. The first thing that we do is we don't shoot in the dark. We put tabs and levers and metrics every single place, as much as we want. This is an insane amount of data. You know, like at one point of time, we were actually producing a terabyte of metrics a day, one single day, where we almost had to keep swapping the Postgres's out because we decided to save it in Postgres for a while. Second is control. One part of reliability is that it requires massive amount of control, which requires massive amount of observation. Control means everything has to go through the same set of principles, same set of mistakes, because when there are same set of mistakes, they are easier to fix as well. Automation, automate everything, whatever you have, because humans will make mistakes. I'll cover that part. Root cause analysis of everything. Every time, and root cause analysis has been an abused term at RCA, because In RCAs, what I've seen most of the times is that we write a description of the issue. Every RCA must yield two things. What was the exact SLI hurt and by how much? Two, what exactly is going to change the next time? Only then an RCA can be called as complete and closed. Another thing that SRE does is cross-org collaboration, which is very important. You know, like until now, every developer, you know, like developer scope is limited to their own teams, etc. But an SRE has to cater as an internal product to the entirety. You know, like if one product has improved its reliability by using a common toolchain, another product should also benefit from it. So there's a cross-org collaboration happening with multiple teams. Lastly is guardrails and frameworks. What I typically mean by that is when you're driving on a road, there are guardrails on both sides, right? Their only purpose is that you do not deviate too much. In case of an accident, the damage can be minimized. This is exactly what the purpose here is as well. To take a tangible example of what guardrail means is, these are small robots that you have seen, you know, like there's a bot for this, there's a bot for that. If you accidentally open a security group which opens up the entire internet traffic, there'll be a bot which will say an alarm that, hey, this has happened. If you're depleting your error, your cloud spend much massively because of a DDoS, one day what happens is that you have actually shot your budget like anything, there'll be a bot which will actually announce it that, hey, I've seen a rapid increase in the amount of cloud spend. Maybe you want to do something with it. These are simple policies and checks that are constantly running in the background. They are preventing failures from becoming catastrophic. They're not eliminating them. They're just minimizing the losses that may happen.
Right.
When we speak of automation, we say that, hey, isn't there Kubernetes and isn't cloud already automated enough? Why do I need more automation? And the reason for that is, and this has been proven over, you know, you ask a human to do a thing thrice over, they will produce three different results each time. There'll be three different bugs each time. And at the end of it, there's going to be one highly demotivated employee because you're asking them to do mundane work. Now you've got four problems. Because now you got three bugs and one employee as well, which you have to address. This is why automation is necessary. Because the sole purpose of engineering is to minimize the deviation that can happen in a given thing. You know, like when you do something over and over, you want repeated output out of it. You want repeatability in your things, and that's what automation helps. The next question is, when do I need that much automation?
Hey Piyush, before, just if you don't mind, just before going on the next slide, there was a quick question about minimizing downtime. So we were talking about reducing failures. So would it mean that if we are trying to minimize downtime, we are simultaneously trying to accelerate recovery rate?
It's a good question on how do we actually minimize downtime? Which goes slightly into the snippet of my next talk. But what we can cover here is minimizing downtime is actually done by doing awesome documentation. While you're on call, you create runbooks. You know, you use these, you dog food your own recipe, right? I'll use automation. I'm going to write scripts because if I am running into an issue where because of Elasticsearch, the JVM heap goes out every now and then, right? Now, this is an issue that I see is happening longer, and I see there's a downtime because of it. I want to ensure that any downtime that happens in a system because of a JVM heap issue should be minimized. So what I should do is I document this. I take back a homework which says, I need better alerting on this. This is a way that I can minimize the downtime. In that period as well, I can make a script rather than going into every single server and actually saying, let me patch it. Let me write a very small script which actually uses either Capistrano or uses Fabric or uses Ansible or anything for that matter, or uses AWS System Manager, where I can go and quickly fix this thing. And this requires quick thinking. This requires a massive amount of experience as well. Does that give a glimpse of it?
I think that gives a decent answer for now. If we have more questions, I'm sure the people will definitely ask, but I think that's fair enough for now.
Got it. So the next question is, when do I need that much automation? Here's the thing, servers can scale, people cannot. Well, people scale, but only horizontally when they eat potato chips. But you know, like, you know, nobody should quote me or blame me for this. I was just making a joke here. So servers can scale. What that means is that anytime when we have these problems, we should capitalize on the fact that increasing the, you cannot throw, keep throwing more bodies at a problem. If we have these repeat things, computers will do a good job of it. And that's where we start investing in automation. And that's why we do automation. Which takes us back to the next question, which a while back, I think it was asked by somebody, is that when do we, what is the right spend and what is the right time to actually focus on SRE? It, the answer itself answers that question earlier as well, and this question as well. At any given point of time, when you reach a state in your business where you realize that something not working the way it should, I'm not just saying the website being up or down, I'm also speaking about customer experiences because of delay, massively delayed response. Imagine I'm trying to buy something or watch something on Netflix, but it takes an hour to just download that video. I'm probably just going to abandon that ship and go watch something else, no matter how badly I want to watch it. But I'll just torrent it for that matter. I'm not advertising torrent, I'm just saying people do that. When the amount of loss is significant enough where you know that by your calculation, the spend that you do to recover that loss is lesser, is when you start thinking of site reliability engineering. What you mean by that is, I'm today at 90% of uptime or latency, whatever my SLO is, you know, whatever those numbers were, let's stick to one and say that because of this, I am losing out on 10% valuable thing, which my competitor is eating. Now, this is a business which amounts to X dollars. By actually employing an SRE team, which also does XY, infrastructure cost, everything, you know, all those line items computed, calculated precisely, I realize that, okay, by doing X by 2, I can recover that X. There's a profit of 50% here. And you say, fine, I need to get this, because there's no other way of it. One of the greatest examples lies in history, December 1, 1913. Where automation proves that how this has actually solved this. This is basically Ford's assembly line. You know, single thing that we can attribute that happened to industry as a greatest thing was this. It used to take 12 hours to make a car, manufacture a car end to end. The Model T, very famous model back then, started manufacturing in 150 minutes. Till that time, over about 10 years, no, 20 years, there were only 1 lakh units sold. After this automation kicked in, within I think 3 years, obviously after the war started, so we can't take that period, I think they sold 1 million units. This is what automation can do. At times we are actually believing that, hey, I don't need automation because I don't have that much scale. It's probably worthy of asking that, do I not have that scale because I do not have the right automation as well, because I have bad customer experience at times? You know, these are fair questions to ask, thought-invoking questions.
Coming so Piyush, does that mean, so someone has asked, so does that mean that we should only start thinking of SRE when failures start happening and we can't handle them on our own in the way in which we are doing it?
While I don't want to advocate it, I would say that when you come out of a state where you actually start, see, when you call it a failure, that means that there was somebody whose experience got hurt. A beta system doesn't have failures, right? Because there's nobody using it, why care about it?
Right.
So when you start reaching that point where the failure is going to hurt some loss, you know, that this, and this loss doesn't always have to be dollar as well. Let's say my only business model right now for the next 2 years is to garner likes on Facebook. What that means is that by actually being down, I cannot have 1 million likes. So the single metric that my business relies on is not working. I will invest in site reliability. I'm actually going to cover this part because the answer is not a black and white. It's a gray, it's a gradation. I'll cover that in my slides next.
Right. Thank you.
One question, fairly famous question that I keep getting asked. But SRE, this is exactly how they sold DevOps when they launched DevOps. How is SRE any different? SRE is not different. DevOps is the larger goal. Developer operations. This is a function that has to be performed. SRE is a way to get there. This is almost saying that functional programming is a way of doing software development. It has its own benefit, but we are not saying that's the only way to do software development. Exactly similarly, there is DevOps and SRE is a way to do that. I just missed that colon got inverse, but you get my point. I did a small mistake that colon should have. Yeah. So SRE is just one of the means that we have come up with paradigm to actually perform and fulfill the role of developer operations, because we realized that that was a larger bucket. The existing operation methodologies were not sufficient. So what exactly did SRE change? Why did we even harp about all of this? If we look, feature development is owned by product developers. Quality is owned by release managers. Who owns the uptime in a system? When there is something which is failing, who do I go and blame? You know, who do I say that, hey, you have the right authority? You know, there's a simple principle, authority and responsibility. Who has the authority and the responsibility to say that if this thing goes down, I'm going to come to you? This is why SRE was born, because in a constant tussle between operations and developers, there was always nobody who could take the single responsibility and say that, hey, I take responsibility for this. And I take it responsibility across the board and not just for one single API call. Uptimes didn't have owners. There was no capacity plan to this. Who owns the capacity plan in the expenditure? And this is exactly why SRE was born. More than, and the reason why this has just come up, actually is not just because it's almost been 2 decades in the making. It is because until 2 decades back, software, I mean, shops weren't open 24/7. Consumption wasn't 24/7. Software has massively escalated. You know, like, I want to upload my kitten photo in the day, in the night. I want to listen to Spotify through the day. I want to watch Netflix through the day. I mean, I want to do so many things through the day. And there is no time limit to it. I mean, people across the globe, business have globalized. And this is why the need of something like this have been felt more and more. And that is what SRE changed. What we can typically say that SRE brought to software development, what assembly line brought to manufacturing. Citing some numbers, because, you know, like, we have a thing for that. Give me the exact numbers, don't give me fluff. Over 60% failures are actually bad deployments and were bad deployments, which we started measuring and we started capturing. Imagine 60% of the times it wasn't working every time. We actually captured that number, the essence of it. 38% issues were repeated. One interesting number, SRE is not an expenditure. What we realized was by action, and this was a non-goal, which actually became a highlight of 2 quarters down our operation. With SRE practice, we actually cut down operation costs by 60% within a year. And this was a massive number because we are a company who are running data centers. Imagine 60% actually being saved. This is money that you have actually earned, which you can spend on further product development. So SRE is not always going to be a cost sink. When you utilize it right, it can actually do things the right way, and which eventually will save you money as well. We go all a cart, right? And here's a question: when you say that, do we go all in? Do I eat it all, or do I start slow? We'll start one by one. SRE has a tiered SRE approach. If your organization doesn't have SRE practice as of now, you don't have to go from 0 to 60 in 1 second. You go one by one. You know, there's this famous skate. I keep bringing this back. There is everything which is correlated to a product development. Think of it like product development. A product, the famous photo, right, where we say that build a skateboard and then a car, while many may disagree with it, but it still works. And similar is the approach for SRE as well. You start with sporadic work, no dedicated SRE staffing. You have the same engineers who are first, this is tier zero. You're actually putting some observability in place. Can you start measuring these numbers? Because unless there is a measurement, there cannot be an improvement. I mean, there will be an improvement which you cannot quantify. Then you start carving out some SRE time, you know, projects which aim at unifying the data set across services to build common improvements. Things like, what are the common things that we're actually making the same mistakes? Where are the common SLIs being lost? Where are they being hurt? What exactly is common to the products, to the APIs? You start with that. Then you move to the next level, where you onboard one service at a time and you set an on-call schedule for that. You set up an on-call schedule that who needs to get alerted first, what is the escalation metrics, see how teams and services adopt. Because, you know, this is going to change a bit of culture of your organization and the processes as well. It's not going to happen overnight. Give it some time. See how teams adapt to it. Because this is going to give more data. You know, this will tell you, hey, this service goes down more often, because of which people need to stay up more often. Now you need to worry about those things as well. So go slowly on that. Once that model has been satisfied, there have been proven SLI improvements, you know, that, hey, the observability that we put in the first place, that was improved by this much. This is a model worth repeating. Repeat that. Onboard other services. Reuse SRE tooling and practices. Go organization. This is how you go about it. Next up. What are the team structures that are actually followed for SRE structures? You know, like there are multiple teams that people have followed. You may pick up one or over the other at any given point of time. It may also change as time changes. One SRE doesn't mean there's only one single SRE. One SRE means one SRE team. I should have written it previously. One SRE team says that it's basically one team, which, because the organization is not that big, so that SRE team can actually do multiple functions. You will actually give them the responsibilities of what traditionally we call as DevOps, CI/CD, capacity planning, architecture reviews, a bit of production testing as well, you know, bunch of these things, because they want control, because if they own the system, they want measurability. So they will have to do those things. It becomes a part of their prerogative, like, and also responsibility, that, look, you got to do these things. That's one SRE. The downside of that approach is that suddenly that team becomes really large, and it may look like, hey, this team is actually bigger than my product team. But technically it's not, because it's just one common unified team for it. Next model that you can pick is common tooling. Common tooling is that there is a team which is actually building tool chains. Their only purpose is that, hey, developers own the systems. We will give them more and more and better tooling out there to do their own jobs. Pro of this team structure is that the SRE team stays minimal. They can actually build an internal product which the other tools, which other developer teams will use based on their input and feedback, that, hey, we don't have time for taking database snapshots every time we release. They will actually build a common tool which will also take into consideration. Remember, SRE is a cross-organization function. They will also speak with the privacy guys and say, can we take a snapshot? And they say, no, the numbers have to be masked. So they build a small tool which actually snapshots a running system at the right time, masks the number, and gives it to the developers to actually go test their systems. Embedded team. What embedded team does is, you have an SRE which is actually on loan and injected into a dev team, which they consult constantly, you know, where they will, like, we are launching a new key value pair. We want to go with Redis Sentinel. And suddenly the SRE, because he has seen the other sides of the other product team, and says, hey, but I've seen other teams use Redis Labs. Why don't we just simply use that? Or somebody says that, hey, but I've been using Portworx for this or some other XYZ project. Let's use that. Reusability is the key. So this borrowed embedded guy or a girl or a person, this SRE, can actually provide better decisions and make that product reliable, that team reliable gradually. Lastly is an outsourced team. Basically, outsourced team doesn't really mean as a business outsource which is sitting elsewhere, but it could be an offshore team which is sitting somewhere, which you consult on need basis. This is the hardest to pull off, but it also has its own benefits, this one. The benefits of this team model is that when it is outsourced, you can actually put clear SLOs and OKRs on their head that they have to do this. But this also runs into friction of interaction with other teams, this model. So this has to be carefully balanced out and requires a higher, I would say both the team leaders need to be on the same page and collaboration level to actually pull this off. But once done, this can actually give real amount of power and authority to the outsourced SRE team to actually bring organization changes faster, because they are not actually dependent on others to execute first. I want to pick up one more talk about this, which is the topic about this, which is the SRE maturity model. What does a journey look like from a 9x to a 99.99, and where does one fit themselves into the thing? And what do the responsibilities look like? A 9x journey or a maturity model of an organization is a very beginner model. You know, here you're beginning. This is why I say that the reliability teething issues start coming. You are actually adapting your software to be canary or have a rolling deployment. You are having coverage validations. You are having SLI collections, observability. You are having an on-call schedule, getting warmed up to it. You are building runbooks. Runbooks are basically a set of repeat tasks that you can perform every time there is a given failure. So what it does is it allows you to actually onboard slightly relatively junior devs, because now there's a set recipe. If X happens, do Y. And this is a knowledge base that you're building. From that point of time, once you've built this, you start moving towards 99. Now here, obviously this is everything which was 9X plus, you can't lose any of that. Now you're building tolerance proofs of a system, that given a downtime, my system will be able to actually handle this. This is where you're adding distributed systems robustness into it as well. You are able to set service level objectives. You are done through the practice phase, and now you're really out there where actually setting this. This is where you also start discovering disaster recovery techniques, you know, because here is where you get a detachment from data. You start realizing that, hey, this is going to be a disaster. I always, at all points of time, have to be ready for it. This is the first time where you start hitting and making those decisions. And the most important one, this is where you build an ability to rollback. Don't go about actually doing automated rollbacks till you reach this point. You know, it's probably over-engineered. From that point onwards, you take a stride towards being automated, which is, here you do chaos engineering. Chaos engineering is a fancy term, but what you're trying to do is, you're trying to inject failures and see how does the system behave accordingly, and does it actually come back up? Do all my recovery, disaster recovery kicks in? Does my rollback work? Do my runbooks work, etc.? You also start building capacity plans, because you have reached a state of maturity where you know a lot about your system, and you can actually start doing forecasting of, when I hit X traffic on Diwali, I will need so much of system, but I don't need it for the shutdown. Things like these, you know, like there are real calls, because at that point of time, you can actually save a decent amount of dollar, and you can actually start making really, really good decisions as well. And here you will take pattern-based re-architecture. You know, no software in the world was written on day one and it was perfect forever. This is where you start re-architecting parts and pieces. I have realized that a certain part of my system doesn't work under stress. Let me start adding cache to this. You know, these decisions start coming up, and you start re-architecting things like that. From that point onwards, where you realize that even a downtime of 99.9 is not acceptable, and you desire to move to 99.99, here the systems have to run in automatic mode. There has to be a failure mode effect analysis report of every single component out there, thoroughly tested. What happens when console goes down? What happens when Postgres goes down? How long does it take for something to back up? How long does it take for an application to come back up? What is the real impact of it? All of these things start coming into the picture. Cost analysis. What is the cost of which line item? By doing what is going to be the expenditure there? If this, then that, automated healing is where this comes in. Because all those runbooks can now be triggered as hooks. If a JVM fails, you have a runbook for it. Just write a simple webhook around it. And this is where it all comes to come. So this is a journey that a maturity has to go through. You know, like any, there may be an abrasion where you say that, look, I get it, I'm at 9X, but I want to have rollbacks. You can pick one. But if you see yourself actually trying to do something on the other side while your system's maturity is on the left side, you see there's something wrong. You know, this is not a golden rule. This is just a yardstick that you can actually use to measure system maturity, and what level of SRE are you aiming at, and what level of the SLIs are you aiming at. Now the question will be, where do I find these SREs, and what are the key skills of a good site reliability engineer? Very foremost important of all, withstand boredom. It's a very mundane job, repeat job. While you're on call, you're going to do the same thing over and over again. And during that boredom is where you have to think of innovation. How can I actually do this again? Because your first job is to bring back a system up and bring it up faster. So that means you're going to keep doing the same thing over and over. And now you also have to think that, how do I prevent this from happening? Attention towards detail. These are soft skills. You know, I prefer these skills over any other hard programming skills, because they are more important. Attention towards detail. One of those numbers is going to lie and is going to tell you the truth as well at the same time. It's going to be a small abrasion somewhere where you catch it. Ah, I get it. This is why it's happening. You get it that we need to invest in, like now servers are degrading, everything looks up. Now suddenly you realize, hey, wait, IOPS are going down as well. You know, these detail is what you need to pay attention to. Strong Unix skills, every system server out there runs on a Linux system. You need to gotta have those programming skills. You don't have to look leftwards to actually ask a programmer to build these simple tools for you. Awesome amount of shell scripting that is required. You must be really good at it and passionate about it. More importantly, it requires an on-call experience, real or assisted, because on-call brings out these skills that people usually have not been faced. You know, communication skills, documentation skills. These are a part of on-call experience, and they real or assisted. You know, somebody can coach you, or you gotta have them by yourself, but you need them. And at the end of it, good statistical skills. Must be able to crunch numbers really fast. Now, one may think that these kids will rob my bank. That's not what an SRE is, right? They're not going to hear for just cost sink. We talked about it, that investing at the right automation and reliability can actually help you save a lot as well and help you build products that your customers love, and that is more important. That's an investment. How do you train these SREs? Because if these are expensive, you obviously can't go out there and actually just hire them all for the best of the job. Well, based on the organization size and maturity, based on where you are in your maturity model, you train them on the job, or they self-learn, or you throw them in the ocean. Each of these approaches is unique to your culture. If you are a company which actually has a lot of time and right now, and you're investing early, you can actually train them on the job. If you're a company which basically is not that much on time, but what you can actually do is that you can actually give them assignments, but that requires good documentation. Last, if you've just hired fresh people, there's a lot of time you can throw them in the ocean. Decreasing order of availability of that person. Once you throw them in the ocean, they take a while to come out. You train them on the job, you can actually start utilizing faster. I'm going to wrap this thing with a few things that we can take away. There's a cost to reliability. Reliability is required, we all know that, but there's a cost that also needs to be paid towards it. 100% reliability is a myth. Reliability can and should be achieved incrementally. Don't aim for that 99.99 on day zero. Reliability is actually a product which is improved in dev sprint cycles. Take data, take measured stab at it, see what's going to improve, see it improve. Give it some time, it will improve. Reliability needs participation from every single stakeholder. It's not some person's thought and whim that I want the system to be this, because it involves multiple products, engineers, business guys, product guys. It has to be a collective decision. Reliability is a function. Somebody just happened to call it site reliability engineering. That's it. Thank you. That's my Twitter handle. This is where I work, CTO and co-founder at Last9.io. We are a reliability company. You can reach out for anything that you may have questions
for. Hey, thanks for the awesome talk, Piyush. I'm sure people would be having questions about what we had as a discussion, and also as from the presentation which you gave. It was really informative for me, at least. I learned quite a few things on this. So, folks, just let us know if you have any questions on the chat or the Q&A. Feel free to give any feedback which you have. And we are up for questions, so feel free to raise your hand on the chat, and I will unmute you so that you can ask your questions away. Okay, so I can see the first question by Aniket. So Aniket puts forward, how do you get the alignment of non-technical and business stakeholders on SLOs? Ooh, interesting question.
Yeah, so here is where numbers will help a lot. When we say a tiered approach, a tier 0, 1, 2, 3, when we start adding observability and measurability to each thing, a micro stab at improving something and the time that and the cost that it took. You know, like the next time that you're faced with a question, why is this bug failing? You have to approach and answer that with a more quantitative number, that this bug happened because we have a failure where we do not monitor our failure rate when we deploy. So people just come in and actually keep deploying in left, right, center. I'm just taking an example. Now, what you do is, this is a number that you've taken. In past 1 week, I've seen 8 failed deployments. You introduce a small change that, hey, every single deployment, just introduce me and you produce a small checklist. People follow that checklist. You actually prove that, hey, by doing this simple measurement, I could actually reduce the failure rate by 4. Now, out of 10 failed deployments, there are only 6 failed deployments. This is an improvement. Now, this is where you start taking in the cost that it has taken. You take this cost and then you actually inject it that, hey, now from where we are, I had to spend X amount of time to get this done. You reverse extrapolate that information to say that this is the cost to go somewhere. So now, next time when you're asked a question, I need 100% fair. I want 100% accuracy. You will actually present a similar number that, look, I think this will be very expensive. Take this into consideration, time into consideration. I'll be able to deliver this within 15 days or 20 days of work and come up with a real assessment. That now the number will be, okay, fine. You know, if that 1% costs me around, and I'll give you real numbers here. At one point of time, we ran a team and, you know, like when you have a really, really large team, you're actually looking at almost around 15 people as well. You know, like it's a massive engineering team that you have to build and to actually gain that. And that was done to actually gain just one extra 1%, which was justified. And this is what defines a real participation from the people. You know, like all these numbers have to be calculated and discussed.
Yeah, I think just to add on Piyush, what Piyush has just said is that I think both the business and the engineering teams have to come together and finalize on the numbers which they want, beyond which you basically have a kill switch saying that, hey, let's not have any deployments. Otherwise, we will just not say, oh, we will maintain your service after this X numbers has been breached, as the error budget, as which we have also come across as a term during the talk. I hope that answers your question, Aniket. Feel free to raise it again, like if you feel we can get into more details. Thanks, Piyush, for answering that. Another question which we had was is by Shivanand, and Shiva asks, what are the deployment methods which we can implement to avoid the downtime? Ooh. Piyush, you want to take a dig at it?
Yeah, I mean, deployment methods, I mean, the first one would be test your system really well. I mean, I know I'm not giving an answer of canary or red green here that you want to listen, but first will be, as much as possible, build a staging pre-prod alpha production kind of versions. Though that, I mean, we don't speak of this as a formal deployment method, but I've seen a lot of people bypass and circumvent this. The incubation period of a bug is actually caught well in this stage process. You know, it doesn't mean there's an added latency. Think of it like you're actually releasing it to early set of users. You know, that is one. Now, once you're finally and fully convinced that this is actually deployable, you may take Canary into sort of a deployment into consideration as well. But one thing that you every time, again, see, I'm always going to give an answer which says there's a trade-off. Now, when you say, I want to pick up models, deployment models like Canary, what you have to think of a server where you are running in an optimal mode. You know, like you are consuming 4 out of 6 cores. A Canary won't work, because now you're out of these servers, because you actually need to provision 4 more on it. So the amount of infrastructure that you will need will actually spike up for a little. And it's a cost trade-off that you'll have to do. Or what you may do is you may go deploy it for only a set of users, which is also a common practice. I think, Tasneek, you are better equipped to answer this question. You handle this on daily basis.
I mean, you've partly mentioned a very important point. I do agree that having a pre-prod is paramount to basically like trying to weed off anything which comes in as a regression inside your release cycle. That being said, another thing which a lot of people foresee as not being important is the importance of end-to-end testing. There's again, there's no silver bullet to have a bug-free release, but I feel personally I've seen that if you have checks like unit tests or having smoke tests and integration tests and end-to-end tests, basically if you are also checking for load tests on your service before pushing it to production, I feel these checks would more or less weed out quite a lot of problems which you would see by just pushing it to production. And of course, like, there are patterns of deployments where you basically give X percentage of traffic to your change which you're trying to introduce, but I feel those come much later, before even before, because even failure rate of some X percentage to Y percentage of customers would be a big thing for some services which are under high throughput, right? So we can elaborate more on this, but I feel there are a few more questions. So without much ado, I hope that answers the question fairly in a decent manner without trying to overlook the details about it. Right, so jumping on to the next question. So Shirish is asking, what are the three most necessary skills needed for SRE?
Withstand boredom, as we already discussed. No, yes. Seriously, that's a real important one. Like, we know we take it into we usually don't talk about this, but these are really, really boring jobs. And one of the things that I really actually encourage young developers as well as that, look, you must have that ability to actually have that perseverance with mundane work, and only then we start thinking about what can be improvised. That is a soft skill. Second, yeah, is a passion towards running, things being done true to a protocol, and this is also a soft skill. I'm not yet, the third one is a real hard skill that I'll talk about, but the second one is like following protocols, because you are a person who is going to set protocols, set guardrails. So you have to be a person who has a passion for it as well, and if we do things in an X way, like somebody who can carry and follow and design a culture as well, that's a very, very important skill. Third one is, I would say a very important skill is being affluent in a programming language, either Go, C++, or Python. Rest everything can be taught, and they must have done some kind of work which interacts with the system. What that means is having done some work of their own on their system. I usually prefer engineers who are actually using Linux on a day-to-day basis and have a familiarity with it, because when they are faced with real systems out there, it almost becomes second nature to them, that their hands move very freely and interacting with those systems. So I would say, I gave you one free, you asked for three. So those are the four skills I would say that you should look out for.
Just to emphasize on one point which Piyush mentioned is, I personally feel the ability to go on headstrong into a problem being fully aware that you might not know everything beforehand on what is needed to solve the problem, I feel a general inquisitiveness and like a can-do attitude works wonders in debugging problems in production. So that is something which I definitely feel is important in debugging production outages and production systems going haywire on a day-to-day, like whenever it happens. I think that was a very good question about what three skills. I think Piyush also answered that in the slides, but yeah. There's a question by Muthu Kumar, if there are any practical steps in general to create, in general to follow to create a better SRE team.
Yes, fire drills. I remember this one time we actually so we were basically traveling to our headquarters of engineering, and we did a mistake of putting every on-call engineer on the same flight. And this is a mistake that we did and we never repeated. Now, one of the masterminds of our team decided to create a hoax downtime. And a hoax downtime where basically it was falsely announced that system has gone down, but the on-call engineers are on a flight for the next 5 hours. While there was no loss, but the chaos that it led to actually taught us the right lessons. These are, I would say, one of the few elements of dry runs that we keep doing, that what is the, I mean, testing your system, etc. Those are things that you'll find on the internet. I'm not talking about those. I'm actually giving you other things that, you know, like which we don't talk about. Even testing whether your teams are fully equipped in terms of documentation, in terms of processes and manuals and runbooks on what to do when a downtime happens. You know, everybody will eventually figure out a problem. The challenge here is, how do we minimize it? And these are the key elements that are required to get there. You know, like this is one of the things that I would say. And this applies to systems as well. You know, like you test your systems, you break your systems. A culture that is very important to breed across engineering is, infrastructure is ephemeral. This is something that takes a long time for engineering teams and product teams to actually sink in, that nothing is forever in terms of infrastructure. You know, servers will go away. So do not make changes which are exclusive to a server. Practically speaking, don't write cron jobs which only run on one machine. Don't go there and by hand inject a cron job. Spend some time using a right orchestrator for a distributed cron. You know, things like these. These are the ones which are a byproduct of the same learnings and same culture that you need to percolate down to every single engine.
Absolutely. Agree with what Piyush has said. To just add on it, I feel automation should not be done prematurely. So if the whole goal of forming an SRE team is to like try to get away with manual things, that should not be the focus initially, and it should be an eventual process. That being said, I feel there are a lot of great takeaways from primarily the SRE book. So if someone has hasn't read it, I feel there are some chapters which do go pretty deep into how Google has eventually achieved the culture which they have. That being said, it's not gospel, so please, it's usually recommended to pick certain things and drop certain things as and when your organization, if it seems to not working for you, then try iterating and modifying it the way it's working for you. But yeah, I guess. Does that answer your question? I feel it's let us know if you have any other questions on this topic. There's another question by Senthil. He asks if there are any tools which we would suggest to measure KPIs.
I'm going to read that as SLIs, I think, right? Because they're technically performance indicators. They're technically the same thing.
Yeah. Service level indicators. Yep.
Yeah. So yep. I think this is tricky. So while there aren't, this is a very new concept. What happens is that there aren't that many off the shelf tools that you can actually go out there. Quite shamelessly, I'll say that the startup that I'm working on, one of our ambitions is actually to make this easier. But again, I'm not endorsing you to actually on this talk. I'm just saying that because there's a very limited availability of off-the-shelf things out there. At times, SREs have to build their own because a lot of these numbers are unique to your interpretation and a byproduct of a lot of those cross-organizational units and metrics that have been spoken about. Example, what I mean by that is, if the only number that is spoken about is expenditure, then your key performance indicators need to be derived around that direction. If the number of, if number of clicks or number of conversions is what is a talk on the floor of your organization, you know, then the key performance indicators will tend to only look at those numbers. So these KPIs actually get derived favoring the talk of the floor. You know, like there aren't that, look, these are X KPIs that you always have to monitor. Obviously, there are engineering KPIs that you can always pick, which are latency, you know, throughput, queue depth. You got correctness is not fairly straightforward. You got percentiles of that. You got, I think these are the fairly standard ones that you will actually find in any tool. You like example, if you're using a load balancer, you can quickly configure these. This is almost what every tool will provide, but anything which is more than just a core engineering KPI will require a bit of massaging based on what is understood by the organization.
Yep, I think that it's a good take, Piyush, on what a service level indicator should be. And so there's another question which is about what would be the follow-up session focus on.
The follow-up session is already announced, and it will largely cover about going into the depth of SRE practices. Like we really talk about technologies and tools, what breaks, what doesn't, how do we make choices. Like simple example, I'm doing automation. Should I use Pulumi? Should I use Terraform? Should I use Ansible? Configuration management, is it dead? Is it the right way? You know, like those are questions, but also deeper insights into, you know, like how sometimes what we see as obvious metrics, they are actually incorrect. They're lying to us. How SLOs can be misleading, like really tangible and I would say implementation level details as well to an extent, not boring as an engineering exercise, but I would say, assuming that one is already doing it, what are the things to watch out for and how can those be improved further?
Awesome. I think that's like a good introduction already into what the next talk would be like by Piyush, so that people are aware of what he's going to cover. So we have another question by Ajit, which is, will we be covering tools for stats gathering, etc.?
I can spend half a minute on it only because you asked, but you'll have to promise you attend the session.
I'm sure Ajit will be attending the session the next time Piyush is giving a talk. Awesome. Yeah. He says cool. Yes.
Cool. 30 seconds for you. Blocked.
Awesome then. I think that's more or less for all the questions which we have as of now. I'll just wait for another minute before handing it over to Zainab if there are no questions. Any questions, folks?
Cool. I think we can call it a wrap.
Thanks, sir.
Zainab, the mic is yours.
Yes, Piyush, I also know that you're hungry since you mentioned rap, but thank you very much, all of us, for joining here today. We promise that we will have better audio gear for Piyush next fortnight. And for all those of you who are curious, visit hasgeek.com/rootconf. Subscribe, follow us, and tell us you know, what topics are of interest to you. And just like Piyush, you can also speak, so drop us a note on rootconf.editorial@hasgeek.com. Or tweet to us on @rootconf. See you in another fortnight with Piyush and a lot more. Thank you, Tazdeek, for moderating the session today. It was fantastic. Thanks, Piyush, and to the other auditors as well. Goodbye and good night.
Bye. Thanks, everyone.
Everyone for attending. Bye.